fun. All right, well, we're sitting here at Sky Komish now. The Scenic Dispatch to BN611. Train number 14 has just pulled into Sky Komish, coupled to the west end of the caboose, and wait for further instructions. And you saw the madness, I think, of last week's. So that was definitely craziness. And then people would come in to chat, and I watched it. Okay. Why is my throttles not working all of a sudden? Dynamics were on. Doing the keys for the first time, all the mistakes I'm gonna make. Let's see, make sure the switches are aligned. Beacons on. About when I first got this DLC, it was like the first time that I bought the game 2 years ago. Oh man, I had so much fun with this thing. Took a lot of pictures, would do a lot of little crazy things. The F-45 happens to be one of my more favorite engines.
So what would be the differences between this engine and the previous one you were using?
Okay, well, the F-45 came out about 1970s. The horsepower rating for this is, it's also a road engine. So, we're talking about 3,000 horsepower here. And it's, at the time, I wonder why that's happening. At the time that this came out, my concentration is just lost. Alright. Let's get us in the direction. Let me get coupled up real quick. Put some power on it. Now, good evening, Tasty Toaster. How are you doing? The F-45 is a road engine, so basically when it comes along the lines of the two, the RS-11 was designed for road switching, going in and doing small jobs, kind of like along the lines of the GP line for the EMD units. So GP meant general purpose. I never figured out what RS meant. And the F-45 was primarily meant for, like, the steam engines. You know, it was meant for the long road. It's a three-axle truck. It's primarily meant for main power line, doing the larger trains. It was designed for the mountain passes. It was designed to deal with tunnels a little bit better than a lot of the others. Although the RS-11 was used a lot of times by the East Coast Railroads a lot for their switching capability, but also their main lines aspects. And this one's here, it's kind of a throwback, meaning F. I'm not exactly sure why F. F, I know, meant freight. And I know that. I'm going to get a good stop before I get there. Let's see, should be really close. F meant freight, and then there was an FP version of it as well. There we go. And the FP meant that it was a freight slash passenger, but primarily they used it for passenger service because it had a steam generator in it. All right. BN train number 14 attached to the air is being transferred. Let's get some brakes on. Otherwise we'll be slipping backwards. Permission to proceed eastbound, scenic dispatch number 14. You have permission to begin your eastbound pull as of 11:19. All right, let's head to the front. Oh, I never did figure that out. No German locos at the moment. Last week was such a shocking thing. I did the RS-11 a little bit earlier. Maybe we can do the German one after this run. This should be a pretty quick jaunt. So I want to run to the front. There we go. Now we're in the front. Some pull going, get some steam, get the lights. Okay, get my beacons going. And away we go. Hello, how are you doing, sir? Yes, I did have some fun with some German locomotives last week. Having issues with definitely, you know, keeping them going and braking and all that fun stuff. It was such a mess. But it was fun. I'm very determined. If that's where we're headed to, maybe I'll do that again tonight. I was just, when I started out this evening, I started out, you know, with no one around, so I did the RS-11 to start out with, and I got into this, being one of my more favorite units, so. And sorry to go back to Montana. Like the second unit that's in here, the SD-40-2, another powerful road unit. However, nowadays you'll see the SD-40-2 as a road switcher because of the power that they need. Mostly the weight of the cars have changed. SD-45s were, or F-45s, SD-45s are pretty much the same thing as a production unit. And it was mainly just the difference between road power and switcher power, you know, because they always kept them separate. They needed the three axles to deal with the mountains, where the general purpose stuff, or the RS-11 type stuff, where there was a two axle setup on the truck, was mostly for switching, road switching, dealing with light cargoes, light trains, moving them into the spur tracks, the smaller routes just to pick up cargo to make the manifest trains, or the, like in this case, this is an intermodal train.
Okay.
So in instance, it was just a more powerful unit and it would serve more purpose to be on the road than to be on the in the yards or doing the small stuff. But nowadays, some of the old road power is doing the same thing as what those smaller units are doing. And by all means, this should be a pretty short run, and then it's only up to the Cascade Tunnel, which is just a few minutes away, probably like, I think it's like 45 minutes, something like that, and then I'll be glad to switch over to the German stuff and try my hand at it again. See how much of a mess I can make. Only got Montana here with me this time, and...
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like the German ones are a bit tougher to handle?
Yeah, and I have to admit, I mean, Tasty Toaster was telling me about it last time, and he said the German stuff was the most difficult to do in the realm when it came to the scenario-based. And it works on a magnetic braking system from what he was telling me, and so he was working with me real close on trying to get the braking going and so forth, and because you're using your throttle, you're keeping your throttle going, but at the same time you're using like the cruise control function to slow yourself down, which actually increases your braking. I think that's the best way to explain it.
Hmm.
It's kind of like throwing an electric motor in reverse, in some cases, which is your dynamic braking on standard U.S. motors. So where you're changing the polarity of the motor itself in American, but there's more of a magnetic system in the German engines. So, and actually, you know, one of the things that did miss from those back days is just not being able to see some of these locomotives in real life. Now, the Montana Rail Link had about four of them up until a couple of years back, and they finally ended up scrapping them because they got a whole brand new order of SD70 ACE units, which are the current models, which are about 5,500 horsepower. So you're looking at an engine that was 3,500 horsepower to tractive effort, and to an engine nowadays which is anywhere between 4,500 to even 6,000 with some of the newer GE units. They only made, I think, if I remember right from reading the stats up on the F45, it was somewhere around about 110 of these, because they ended up going to the SD45, which was more along the lines of the SD40. Southern Pacific, Santa Fe, Burlington Northern, obviously, and a few other railroads enjoyed the F45, but they preferred the SD45 over the F45, just because mainly if you look at the difference between the SD40 and the F45, the SD40 allows you more access and easy access to maintain and just the stuff for the diesel engine, where the cowlings sometimes get in the way.
I can see a bit more what you're talking about with the terrain earlier when it's not covered in snow.
Yeah, yeah. Well, how the ground looks opaque and flat and just doesn't have any texture to it.
Yeah, just a few colored splotches, kind of.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But that's not really the focus.
Yeah, that's right. Most of the focus is on the engine and so forth. However, that is one of the major complaints I get from other people that play the game. And then I hear that from other people who haven't played the game quite yet. And what I say, because you look at the trees too in some aspects, and it's like, oh, well, why can't we get some sort of depth to our graphics, because the trees kind of look like paper, although they do look a lot better than what they used to look like.
Yeah, there's so many people complain about graphics in games like that come out now, and I mean, just look back 10, 20 years and what they had then, and people didn't complain about it back then, you know?
Yeah.
That was amazing.
Yeah.
And now it's like, oh, it doesn't look like real life.
It doesn't look good enough. It's not good enough to what we have now. I can't play this anymore.
And then you just gotta be like, calm down. Go back. Fire up your... whatever you want to put up, your Atari, your NES, put in some old classic games and have some fun.
Exactly. Well, and it's like me too. I mean, I was looking at, what was it? I'm trying to think about what video I was watching. I was watching something to do with Wasteland, I think it was, because I just saw Wasteland production put together and how they came up with it and how they crowdfunded it and so forth. And I was just realizing how bad the graphics were on the Apple IIe, and how technically we didn't have any graphics. We only had just 2D images that would kind of move, you know, pixels. And you sit there and you go, well, you know, even the first flight simulators that came out, that most of us enjoy and so forth, were still, I mean, lined square pixel, you know, pixels, and that's about it. And The simulators always seem to lag behind like the mainstream games, as you know. So it's to see games like simulator games like this to be actually putting some effort and focus into it with ease is kind of nice. And then, but then of course, like you said, everybody wants to see more higher details.
Things have come a long way. Not that long of a time.
Yeah. Problem is now I want to live.
And it's almost like, it almost, when it comes this fast, people don't appreciate it as much as they should.
Yeah, or they're just getting into it, and then they don't understand when they go back to an older game.
Mm-hmm.
I know that I remember StarCraft coming out. I remember the videos coming out for some of the previous ones, and it was like, wow. Crazy, I think we've got about another 20 minutes or so. Show you real quick here on the map. Our task is only pretty much just to get to the Cascade Tunnel, and that's right about here. So once we get there, it ends. So we got a couple stops to go through. Now, one of the things that's actually going to be nice, I'm hoping that probably they're later in December or mid-December. I might actually be headed up to Seattle. I have to go pick up a couple things from my father, so maybe even January. And one of my plans is while I'm up there for a couple days, is to actually go up here to Stevens Pass. I used to come up here as a kid. And I'd used to watch trains go through here with my dad and try to get some footage while I'm up there. And it'd be dead of the winter. There'll be snow on the ground. It'll be great. I'm also going to try to get some footage of Stampede Pass, which happens to be a little bit to the south. Kersey is saying, oh, right, this is my first time watching Train Simulator 2016. I forgot it came out. Yeah, it only just came out in September, the 2016 version. Although it's basically the same as the 2015 version and even the 2014 version. And not much changes, some braking changes, some, you know, not really any graphical changes nonetheless.
Well, a lot of games that come out here are like that. You don't see huge amounts of change in each individual one, but over time, you know.
Yeah, and it's like I said, sometime this year. I haven't read the forums lately. I mean, they were talking originally that they were going to do it 3 months after the release of 2016, and obviously, well, it's been 3 months and I haven't heard a thing about it. Because they want to go to the Unreal Engine to make it a little bit better. But even with this graphics engine that they're using, they have frame rate issues. I mean, I'm kind of stuttering a little bit here. I can't get it above 35 frames. But they are, I mean, the textures are improving on the engines. The newer stuff is meshing. They're able to keep up some of the older stuff. Like, I mean, even from this perspective, let's see if I can get a good view. The bridges on this used to be a lot worse. They used to be a lot blockier, and now you're starting to see some really good quality come out of them. Or they're actually looking like bridges instead of just pixels, flat surfaces that have geometric shape to them. And then, like, now there's LED lighting signals that's new. Now, for some reason, Stevens Pass DLC seems to always be a little bit ahead of the curve than everybody else. It's been well put together. In fact, I mean, even the map that's a little bit down below that you can't see, I try to, when I do these broadcasts, try to give you most visual that you can get out of it, because some of that's the aspect to it. But the mapping down below will tell you when there's tunnels, when there's bridges, when there's speed changes, where you're changing to a little bit more. And I think it has to do with dependent upon the author who's creating this, you know, the DLC packages. But the Stevens Pass one seems to stay current. Where, like, with the Sherman Hill one or a few of the others, it's a little bit more out of date and you don't get all that function. It's like, okay, well, when's the tunnel coming up so I can close the valve on my steam engine, or so I don't get blowback and kill my crew. Oops. Yeah, again, let's see if we can take a look at this bridge. But you can see the flatness of the trees. Not really. Still getting used to the camera. Kersey is saying, I remember that from 2015, the map on the bottom. Yeah, it's all there. In fact, this time around, this is the first time I've actually really trying to run with the keys. Usually I have the controls up there, so. In fact, for Tasty, when we go to potentially do the German stuff here in a little bit, potentially, when we go to do the German stuff here, it'll be much more of a challenge for me because now I won't even have those controls up. So, it's like...
What do you mean? It'll be more fun.
It will be. You'll see. You know, it's like I wanted to put my face up today, but I just wasn't able to get the cam to function right. And the green screen still isn't here. I ordered it from Amazon. I'll probably have it by Tuesday. But at least I got chat up in the game. I mean, when I start making these weird expressions, it's like grunting and groaning and all that stuff is one thing, and I just do that live. I mean, I always do that even when nobody's watching me. It's like, ooh! Breathing heavy. It's like,
mm-hmm.
Even if it's just, you know, something that shouldn't be bothering me, but, you know, I guess that's what part of the expressions are.
I kind of wish we had some videos once in a while. Some of the saltier rants that we've had from some of the people in here.
Yeah, but then the content that I would have to label it.
Well, not even necessarily in streaming, I'm just saying in general.
Yeah. Well, actually, I got some of it. Some of it's shown up in my videos, and, I've edited it out. But I still have some of the raw stock. One of the goals I'm trying to do is just, I'm trying really, really hard. I mean, in some cases, it's just not, it's going to happen where there's going to be some swearing and so forth. Or some real nasty stuff come through. But it's, I'm trying to keep everything as clean, especially when it comes to the videos. Because I'm trying to, you know, since the trains is my passion and so forth, at least in American stuff, I've never got into the German stuff so much or the overseas stuff. So this is my new experience of working with you guys here, is to bring that passion to the forefront and to share it with even the younger generations. But if it's, you know, there's a lot of background saltiness and all that stuff, then it just makes it much harder for the parents to accept that.
Yeah, I wasn't even talking about in regards to streaming these games and stuff. I'm just saying, like, some of the stuff we've had in our client. Oh, what was it, like a week ago with Bismarck going off on his Kantai stuff? I would have loved to see a video of that.
That's true. It, you know, it is one of the thoughts, though. It's like, I'm thinking about doing that with some of the content on YouTube, but it's like, I don't know if I really want to do that yet.
It depends. You can have different categories of videos.
Yeah. Although I must say, you know, it's been a while since I've run Steven's Pass, and this actually looks better than what it was before. I'll probably be putting up some more pictures that I took a long time ago, 2 years ago back. I mean, they've added more grass. See, where are we at? Maybe about 10-15 minutes tops until we get up there. Oops. Oops, oops. I still get button pushy. It's like I have my fingers like hovering over the button and it's like click, boom. It's kind of funny because at the end of one of those trips, passenger trips in the DBBR 101, it was like I kind of got button pushy because people came in and couldn't stop the train, and I accelerated and derailed at the very end into the platform, passenger platform. Yeah, if the speed was higher, true. I you know, one of the things I never quite understood is, especially with going through Stevens Pass with all its modernizations, when I was a kid and growing up in Seattle, when Stevens Pass only first got its first set of concrete ties, and I'm surprised that they never increased the speed limit on Stevens Pass, and then or just set it up based on weather. The other funny part is I never understood either why they didn't straighten out some of their edges just to invest a little bit more into the line itself and straighten it out so they could get more cargo over it. Instead, they opened up a Stampede Pass. So now Stevens Pass is primarily a westward rail line. So Stevens Pass will go west. The Stampede Pass, which happens to be further to the south, and Snoqualmie Pass area, goes eastbound. So all eastbound freight goes out through Stampede, and all westbound freight coming into Seattle goes through Stevens. Now, Stevens Pass used to be the Great Northern Line, and closer to the Cascade Tunnel, there's the old Cascade Tunnel, which is still there, although it is falling apart. I've walked actually through the old Cascade Tunnel. I never understood either why they just didn't, with all the modernizations that of this time too, is reopen the old Cascade Tunnel to add more traffic to it as well. But it's all a money thing that I just don't understand. So, I look at investing in railroad and infrastructure, I guess, more than actual profit, because to me it's like I tend to look at the long term rather than the short term goals. And I guess when you get stock portfolios and when your stock people want money, it's like, okay, well, yeah, you gotta deal with your stock people and your investors first before you deal with the actual investment of the company and the long term goals. But to me, railroading is a long-term function, you know, spans over hundreds of years. And it's going to be around for probably another 50 to 100 years or more unless they come up with something that's better or easier to transport goods.
But even if they did, they'd have to put a lot of money into it just to renovate everything, you know?
Yeah, especially with maglev trains and all that stuff. But then again, I notice that most of the contractors usually get way overpaid too for that kind of stuff. And it's like, I don't like this, the high-speed rail that's supposed to go through from San Francisco to LA. It's, to me, it just seems highly overpriced for what it really is, being that it's the first high-speed rail that the U.S. is about to put together.
Mm-hmm.
Gersy says, I've only had two train sets and haven't been able to find one I've liked to see one. I like some since then. Sorry. Can't read either. Mouth is gibberish. Yeah, I still actually have my original HO setup. My first two engines that I ever bought, model railroading wise, was an SD40-2 and a GP38-2, both from Athern. The GP38 actually had the stripes in error. They were put on backwards. And I actually still have them to today. I bought them at the age of 14. You know, with the help of my dad, obviously. And that's when I was doing the Model Railroad Club. So there's a little warm heart for Burlington Northern in my little back of my head. Yeah, you know, a little love for it. And it's also probably the reason why I like the Montana Rail Link as well, because of their blue and black paint scheme. And over time, I picked up a couple other engines as well. I think I've got like 15 or 20 engines at the moment. But because I'm getting more and more in depth into Train Simulator 2016, I'm actually potentially going to let go of my model railroading stuff and sell it up on my eBay site. Because it's just so much easier to deal with digital aspects of certain things, and I'm really getting into the digital aspect, plus I'm not getting any younger either, so. So it's like sitting
on the whole world is moving toward digital.
Yeah, yeah. Although, you know, the model railroad scene, or any of the scenes out there are getting better though too. And it's expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any hobbies outside of just computers, gaming, and all that, Montana?
Well, most of the things I do are on computers, but I do spread it out on a few different things. I mean, besides the gaming and the anime, I also delve into sports a bit, like fantasy football.
Nice.
Wouldn't say I'd be the best actual athlete. I know the game.
Gotcha. I could never get into the fantasy aspect of sports. Just, it didn't interest me. I don't know why.
There's a pretty big difference there, because a lot of people have, you know, their favorite team. They want to root for their favorite team and nothing else. And if that's it, then fantasy football probably isn't for you, or any fantasy sport itself. Fantasy sports kind of require you to know all the teams and all the players and, you know, not be too biased toward one of them, at least when you're picking.
Gotcha. Playing with the view things. I was trying to find there's supposedly a function that you can I still haven't learned all the keys yet. Yeah, you know the funny thing about that too, though, is a couple of years back, it's been a while since I was paying attention to sports. There was a basketball pool going on at my job at the time, and I ended up picking the first round of games based on what I remember from rivalries. For home games.
Oh, you're doing the CAA tournament?
Yeah, something like that. So it was all based on rivalries, and I ended up getting all but like four right for their first game of the season.
Yeah. That's the thing with the bracket tournament picks for the NCAA tournament. The first games are usually pretty good, because you'll obviously have the, you know, ones versus 16s that are easy picks. And but as you go along, one loss or two losses in the first couple rounds will kill you later on if they're one of the teams you had picked going deep into it.
Gotcha. Slowly chugging it up. Let's see, where are we? No, we're getting close. I better get in the cab and see what this light is. I think I can see a yellow blinking light, which means we'll be coming to a stop here pretty soon. And I've been taking some time to go up to Hatchepi to watch the trains up there on the loop. I've been quite enjoying that. I've been going up there maybe every other weekend or so. I met a couple people that through the last couple of times up there. In fact, met this wonderful gentleman that came in from Australia to do a 10-week tour of trains. It was fun talking to him. He was actually in Brisbane instead of Melbourne, where our famous Hots of Horror is at.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just kind of funny that the types of people that you meet, the individuals that you meet, is just so strange.
Oh yeah. That's another thing I do like about spending a lot of time online, is you really do find people from all over the world.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, what is it, Tasty Toaster, you're from England, right? No, I don't remember. And I don't think I've ever asked Cheese. And once in a while we get Hots of Horrors from Australia. Who else do we got? We got a lot of Canadians.
Well, we also have Australia from Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah, a bunch of Canadians. I swear we have somebody from like Romania or something.
Yeah, Tasty. And Cheese, I was wondering where you guys were from, because I thought you mentioned, I know Tasty, you were talking, I think you said you were from England, if I remember right. But I'm not exactly sure about that. It may have been Germany. There's a couple people that I've talked to that said, you know, from different locations. Oh, I've never asked you, Cheese, where you're at. Canada. Okay, Canada. Oh, surprising thing. I just keep forgetting small details. I actually have an F-45. On my model sets. Never finished it, actually. I was adding ditch lights to it. Quebec? I hear the food's better up there. Although I do like British Columbia quite a bit. I used to visit that when I was living in Seattle quite often. Looks like we're getting closer to the top. And we get to try the experiment of the... experiment of me driving German trains again. Do you want me to go back to the DBBR 101s? Try that run again? The Tasty? We had so much fun last time. Oh, you're 2 hours south of Chicago, Cheese. Okay. My wife is actually from Chicago. I've been out there a couple times. I think it's what, South Park? Not South Park, North Bend. North Bend? North Bend. I can't remember. It's the other regional airport that's in the other, moves over to the next state. Been through there when I go out to Michigan. Usually take a bus from the O'Hare out that way. Yes, I do have a couple British routes. again, never traveled them. Unless you're trying to make it easy on me. I got that new Riviera route. I think it's the British route.
Oh yeah, just checking up the people on TeamSpeak right now. And I forgot about that. Valkyria is actually from Sweden.
Is Valkyrie from Sweden? I guess. Yeah, I keep forgetting about that. He sounds more Canadian than he does Swedish.
He doesn't really talk that much. He usually just texts.
Or goes boy.
Or that.
I have the starting British house. We'll have to take a look when we go out. It's just, you know, I think we used to have a few more people from all over when we had more people in the clan. It's lately been a little bit drier than normal. But then again, most of the time that most of us are on is during the West Coast period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes when I stay up really late into like the AM hours, there's a few other people that I see pop on that I don't see otherwise.
Yeah. Alright, I'm screwing up all the camera views. I know I used to be up until real late in the morning, real late at night. Get most of the Aussies between Hatsuhara and Bestie. And it's like lately I haven't been on that late. I've actually been going to bed at a decent time. Problem is I've been getting up at like
6. Times for me to be pretty random too.
Yeah. Because I hardly see you on, at least lately. But I know you're busy as well.
Yeah, it depends on the day.
I know, lately I've been getting up at like 6 o'clock in the morning just so that I can start editing stuff for YouTube, and then I won't get done until like 7 or 8 o'clock at night.
Mm-hmm. I'd say I'm usually on TeamSpeak every 4 or 5 hours a day, but it'll vary what times that's on. Yeah. But I try to keep it on the evening times.
Sometimes the cameras are not exactly nice. You know, I actually tried this game when it was Microsoft Train Simulator, and I could not get into it. The engine's detail was so flat. The game was even flatter than what it is today, and it was like, ew. And then I played 2014, and it was like, this is nice. And then learned later it was actually Microsoft Train Simulator just taken over by Dovetail. Oh, Scenic Smash 14, I'm going to have to put you on hold at Scenic to let the westbound fumes clear from the Cascade Tunnel. That and BN Extra 6619 West will be in the clear for you at Scenic. Dispatch out. Okay, well, I guess I'm gonna have to stop it up here. One of the things I definitely have noticed is I gotta try a little bit harder to open my mouth and talk, because sometimes I mumble still. The other thing I miss is my white screens. I haven't been able to quite... I got 3 screens that I run with, and I haven't quite been able to figure out how to twitch with all 3 screens because the resolution just doesn't really sync up well. I miss my periphery vision. actually this will probably end this one, and probably won't see this one for a while until I can figure out how to set up some AI computers going on. Do you guys Tasty and Cheese and I cannot say your name, Le Trapeau Four? Yeah, I'm going to butcher names all left and right. Do you guys prefer the foreign rail over American rail or North American rail? Or passenger service over freight service, that kind of thing?
Don't worry too much about the names. They couldn't possibly get as annoyed as Icy.
True. The Trapa Fu. Okay, the Trapa Fu. I'm just dangerous enough with my pronunciations that, you know, I can trip over my own tongue at some point. I know at some point, too, I will probably be getting either my Ventrilo server up open to anybody who wants to join it, potentially another TeamSpeak server open up as well, so you guys can at least chat with each other. American freight for cheese. Okay. Yeah, I'm a big freight guy. That's for sure. Let's see. I'm sure we'll see this engine light up here in a second. Cajon Pass. Okay. Yeah, I want to do actually some more stuff with Cajon. It seems to be one of those DLCs that you don't see used a lot. And I'd like to actually go in and eventually adjust the route in the DLC itself. And add the Burlington Northern lines that are in there. I mean, it's partially added right now, but to really fully add in those second rails so that you can travel and get the depiction of what the rest of the pass looks like as well, and add more AI. I mean, that again, this is that learning curve, getting more and more involved into the game. One of the things I tried doing here originally was adding in the old Cascade Tunnel to this one as well. Oh, you own Cajon Pass too, awesome. And nice to see you, Bizarre. And I think I was mentioning before in the past to Cheese that definitely want to get more into the idea of when I get start to understand a little bit more about how the scenery adaption or the editing aspect of it is, to really show you guys how to use it, because one of the biggest problems with this game is there is no real information about setting up or editing scenery like this and adding more trackage or changing things that you want to do, or even creating your own layout. I know there's a good couple tutorials out there, but nothing really that shows you what to do, and I'm struggling, even as adept as I am with games and so forth, to even cope or comprehend how to do all that stuff. I mean, yeah, I can lay out track and lay it out for miles, but how can I do it efficiently, or how can I show you efficiently? Yes, it is a double stack container train. It's one of the part is one of the missions or scenarios here for the F-45. There's only two right now for the F-45 from that DLC. And one of them is this train right here. Let's see, where am I supposed to stop? Probably at the signal. Yep. I double stacks, and as you can tell, I think this is one of the modified ones. Thinking. No, this one came with it. But I also have some skins for cars too, and I'll be showing them in some of the tutorials on YouTube. I haven't got into the idea of trying to figure out how to deal with the car setup with the YouTube. Probably will kind of do it the same way I've been doing the first engines, but I think once I get a better idea of how I'm going to do the engines, then a little bit more with their reskins in the further episodes, I'll be able to deal with the cars too. Yeah, you can do passenger trains like Amtrak as well. Tasty was talking to me potentially about doing British routes. I'll go out and I'll show you guys what I've got. One of the plans coming up here pretty soon is I'm going to get some Google Docs together, because I just found that it's probably the most efficient way of putting information out there. So yes, I have steam trains as well. I don't have a lot of the British stuff or the German stuff. Again, I wonder where it wants me to stop. But I will be putting up a complete document, a Google Doc, like a spreadsheet of everything I have, and then try to, when it comes to twitching, try to let you guys make that choice. All future plans, of course. I'm actually spending, because the amount of time I've been learning how to edit YouTube videos probably the last 4 weeks, and I'm finally getting to a point now where it's not taking me 6 hours to do one episode. So I'll hopefully be able to spend more time on Twitch, because I spend probably about an hour, maybe 2 hours before every stream to upgrade and enhance the Twitch process. Well, what's my favorite locomotive? Favorite location to drive trains. Stevens Pass is probably one of my most favorite, because it's just a childhood thing. Plus, it's also really well put together DLC. The other one is, I can never say the name of the pass, and I've been meaning to look it up, the Marineris, or the M-A-R-I-S-S. It's a break. Hopefully this is where they want me to stop. I want to be able to complete this one and get it out. No, I think they wanted me to stop further up. So Stevens Pass is one of my favorite. The Marineris Pass is my other favorite. Marineris a little bit more lately. I've been running it, but that's because there's a couple places on there that I can get some really good screenshots. They almost look like picture quality to some degree. But Stevens Pass is definitely more well put together out of all the DLC routes that I've run into. Okay, let's see if I can get up here. There we go. So I would say those two overall. Some of the other DLCs are well put together too. But it's mostly based on what my childhood experiences are. Okay, I'm here. Doesn't like it. Oh, there it goes. There goes the timer. Cool. I think one of the... Bizarre, do you know what the SL Amtrak train is in Washington, D.C.? I know it. I remember when it was first delivered to Amtrak. Okay, let me read this real quick. Good run. It will be about 20 minutes for the westbound fumes to blow out of the tunnel. take a well-deserved break. Scenario complete.